King Herod heard of the disciples preaching, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved. Yet, out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately, the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
You may be seated. How's that for an uplifting passage? And I'm sure everyone here was inspired by and completely understood that reading from Ephesians, right? If you're one of those who didn't catch it all at first reading, like me, then don't feel disheartened. The entire passage that Ed read from Ephesians a while ago, verse 3 through 14, is actually in Greek one long sentence with clause after clause hung on one another. It is the longest continual sentence in the New Testament. And one of my preaching professors once said, if there's a passage that bothers or confuses you, that's the one you should be preaching on because it's probably doing the same to your people. And since I preached on John the Baptist's situation the last time these texts came around, guess what the text for today's sermon is? It's an amazing passage, actually, this one from Ephesians. It's really a kind of hymn singing God's praises and offering God's thank you for who God is, for what God has done, and for what God is doing. When you read it in your mind, you ought to have an attitude that's almost, God, you know, like that. It should be, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, and that us meaning the church, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. In other words, thanks be to God who has given us, Christ's church, everything we need to live this life for God's purposes, every spiritual gift that exists in heaven to use in this life for God's purpose. And thanks be to God who has chosen us and made us blameless by God's will and by God's choice for God's purpose. From the very beginning, total emphasis as he begins this sentence on God's gracious action. I think that's a clue for us in life too. The foundation, the beginning of everything is God's gracious action. God gives, we receive. Like the rest of the story, it's all about what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do. We are simply blessed and empowered and then called as co-workers with God in God's mission. How often do you think about that? You, baptized child of God, have been called as a co-worker with God in God's great mission in the world. It goes on to say, He destined us for adoption as His children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace that He freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. Meaning God decided in advance to make us His children. Once again, it's not about us choosing God, it's about God deciding and choosing us. And the only appropriate response from us is then to live a life of thanksgiving. As the old phrase says, to live a life worthy of the call. And he continues, in Jesus Christ we have, present tense, in Jesus Christ we have redemption through his blood. We have, present tense, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches he lavished on us. Again, it's all about God's grace and God's action for God's children. And then there is a shift in this extended sentence. He says, with all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ. In other words, God has a plan that pleases him, that he is revealing to the church. Now, I hear people talking about God's plan for their life rather frequently. And I do believe God has a plan for your life. But I really don't think that plan is about who you should marry and what job you should take. And then you just have to figure out what that plan is and all will go well in life. I hear people talking that way. No, no, no. God's plan for your life and for the world is something much bigger. It's on a much grander scale than that. Let's look at what it is. It's in verse 10. It says, a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in Christ. Things in heaven, things on earth. Gather up all things in Christ. Now that is a big plan. All things. And the word in Greek is panta, and it is an all-inclusive word. God's plan is to unite all things in Christ. That means all people. It includes your kids you worry about because they haven't been in church since they left for college. It means your neighbor who's a sweet lady but is rather church averse. It means that ornery old guy down the block. All people. It means dogs, cats, horses, even mosquitoes. All creation. Yeah, I know the mosquitoes, yeah. But it is that kind of inclusive a term. It's a message and a plan that's reiterated in 2 Corinthians where it says, in Christ God was reconciling the world to himself, entrusting this message of reconciliation to us. And there, that word for the world, cosmos, is an all-inclusive term as well, meaning all people, all animals, all creation. You talk about good news, right? Sound a bit radical? Well, okay, but I'm just sharing what the text says. Oh, and wait, there's more. Back to Ephesians. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of Him who accomplishes all things according to His counsel and will. Meaning, those of us who are in Christ, who have been baptized into Christ, have now received an inheritance from God, the God who is the one true authority over everything. What's that inheritance? It's not billions and billions of dollars. It's this. So that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of His glory. Our grand purpose, the plan God has for our lives, our inheritance, is that we are now freed to live for God's glory. We don't have to worry about where we stand in this relationship with God. God has already decided for us, and the plan God has for us now is to live a life of freedom, a life that is, again, worthy of the call. Freed to live for God's glory. What does that mean? Well, it's not that we just sit around singing God's praises all day, although I am convinced we often do experience the presence of God in music. But if you read on in Ephesians, this living to God's glory means that it is our calling in life to be part of what Christ is doing in this world. We have been named as God's reconciliation team. God has made us part of God's great uniting all things work in this world, this ministry of reconciliation. Reconciling people to people, meaning we're to work to restore relationships between individual people and even between nations. Wherever there is hatred and division, it is our godly calling to work to restore healthy relationships. Peace between individuals, peace between communities, yes, even Longhorns and Aggies, peace between nations. God has blessed us and called us and then goes with us as we seek to bring peace and unity to all creation. We are never sent out alone. God always leads the way. And this reconciling work goes even further. It is truly all-encompassing. Follow me. It means we also seek to reconcile people to God's desire for people, bringing those things together. I'm not saying it's our job to fix others and tell them how to live as though we were somehow superior, far from it. But this reconciling all things work includes reconciling people to health, people to contentment, people to joy, people to life, to all those things that God desires for us that we have been cut off from. Even reconciling people with God's beloved creation as we seek to care for God's earth. That too is a reconciling work. It all ties back to the things we saw Jesus do and heard Jesus say. Following Jesus, living out our inheritance from God, means that we use life and all our resources to bring health to the sick, food to the hungry, hope to the downtrodden, reunion to the broken. We, the baptized people of God, Christ's church, are privileged, the text says. But privileged in a way that's different from how most folks think of it. Our privilege is that we have been given a glimpse of what God is up to in this world, in and through Christ Jesus, bringing all things, all this broken, damaged world, together in Him. And we are privileged to be called by God to be God's grand reconciliation. You know, maybe we need to have some team shirts made that say GRT in big letters, Grand Reconciliation Team. And these shirts could remind us of our purpose in life. reconciliation, and hope and life to a world so badly in need of all those things. To God be the glory.